For me, it is about 5 o'clock in the morning. So if I'm not that quick, you know why it is. I accept donations in the form of coffee. So, and the subject of today would be, and I saw that Roderick put in the schedule that I was talking about Rex, which is undoubtedly true, because I always do. But this time it would be pipelines on Netrex, because of two of the three things which I'm going to talk about are born on OS2, give or take, which is Netrex, which is Mike Collishaw's new improved Java-based Rex. IBM's Java was born on OS2. That was a small project in Hursley, somewhere in 1995. And let me switch to the presentation. And Pipelines was born on ZVM. So let me see the hands. Who knows VM and has worked on it? That's not as many persons as I expected. So the thing is, I'm going to do a very small, very quick run through of some computing history, which I'm going to do very quickly. This was invented in the war, almost all of it, and it was secret for a lot of time. And of course, people took the blueprints and things, and we skip a number of years, and then my first computer was actually the CDC Cyber in Watergraafsmeer, which was a supercomputer, which means it had 200 megaflops a second, which is now, I think your phone has some petaflops in it already. But that was it was a real supercomputer. It was the only one in Europe. I remember there were always timings problems on it, and they had long rounds of cable stashed away in cupboards, because they had to delay some of the boards to reach the other boards, because they never got it quite right. My first job was a 3090. Actually, it came in together with me. I think it was a 4380-81 for the people who know that, which was the very large, you know, the whole floor of the building having disk and cooling, and very noisy and also very cold, because I started out as a system programmer. I always had to bring a sweater, because if you stayed for prolonged times on the computer floor, you would get the flu immediately. Well, today it's the Raspberry, which runs circles around the 3090, for people who appreciate it. So the 360 was the first compatible line of computers. Before that, every computer had their own new improved instruction set, which was nice because it was new and better, which was also for companies not so nice, because you had to rewrite all your software, which was mostly assembler, COBOL, Fortran in those days. And I'm going to quickly skip through these things. So in 62, which was when I was born, we had CTSS. It was an experiment in time sharing. It was called the compatible time sharing system, because it needed to be compatible with the Fortran monitor that run at the same time at the same machine, the 360s. In 65, nearly everyone was convinced that this was the wave of the future. I mean, there would be few computers. They would be somewhere else, not in your room. You would connect to it and you could work on it. The whole time sharing thing was because the professors at MIT were very impatient and didn't want to wait until all the students' punch card Fortran jobs had finished. They would sit and they would like to type in their formulas and do their scientific important work with their professors. They get paid more, so it must be more important. So this is when Multics was started. Multics was, of course, the thing that tripped up IBM in the 360 line, because MIT wanted to have virtual storage. which wasn't there yet in IBM stuff. It was a disaster marketing wise for IBM, and they lost the deal to Honeywell. And then of course we had the big split in computing, where one line was the IBM mainframe OS VM line, the other line was going to be Multics via Minix to Linux, and fortunately it came together. Multics lives again, which is very nice to mention. Some kind people wrote a simulator for the hardware, and although we thought it died in the year 2000, you can now download the simulator, you can download the last version of Multics, and you can run it at home. It is amazing, I think, because we only knew it from the people who liked Unix and needed to write about how bad Multics was. For system types like me, it's not bad at all, because it's very structured. You've got all kinds of tools like profilers and debuggers all built in the OS, so which means they all work for all kinds of software, for all your PL1, COBOL, Fortran stuff. Multics was written in PL1, which this is a contemporary advertisement, which means even girls can write. Now we don't have to write in assembler anymore. How times have changed. Well, not really, I think, because there are very few women in the audience. This was all my whole career. If I stepped into an IBM course and there were women in there, it was always DisplayRite 360 or Office, Prof's Office for VM and stuff. So it's still a bit odd. Well, in the meantime, IBM had a shock, because they were not chosen for important scientific work, and they ordered a time-sharing system, which turned out to be VM. VM still exists. I did some work on VM. Well, I did some work twice in my career. The first time was in 1987, when we ran MVSs under VM. The second time was in 2018, late 2018, until March of this year. Which was very funny, because my fingers still knew some of the commands that my head already had forgotten a long time. You can run it at home. There are even open source, by IBM open sourced versions of VM. Those are not the modern 64-bit HyperSockets versions, of course. And for the rest, I think we skip this, because the subject is pipelines. Pipelines were born on VM. So I'm now going to skip to today's presentation. So what is a pipeline? If you don't know VM, you probably only know the Unix DOS versions of pipelines, which is a bit of a simplified version. Actually, pipelines on the mainframe are multi-stage parallel scheduled tasks that make work a lot easier, because it is based on the data flow paradigm. So you've got data and you push it through a pipeline. There are different stages in which you can modify that data, and without writing a real program, putting stuff together to get to your results easier. In my personal history, I got acquainted with networks through pipes, because I was interested in pipes, which was a long time ago. And I wrote some stages for networks. And everybody knows networks. Some people used it.
But it sounds very much like MQ.
It is Rex. It's made by the inventor of Rex. But its runtime is Java, which is not it's not a great coincidence, because when Michael Lischel ported Java to IBM platforms, starting on OS 2, which makes it very relevant for today's talk, he wondered how a Rex language on a Java virtual machine, what it would look like. Not very surprisingly, it looks very much like Rex. He implemented some of the things that he always wanted to implement in Rex, but didn't do, like case insensitive comparisons. He wanted to do that, but he was talked out of it by his colleagues in Yorktown Heights, the lab. He always regretted that, and so there are some small differences. Also, it has the class structure of Java. You've got, so you can use classes and methods. You can inherit stuff. You can be object-oriented, slightly different from OORex, which is another, which is actually designed by Simon Nash, which was, he was down the hallway in Hursley. And when, you know, in the 90s, when object orientation broke out, I don't know if you remember that, because now everything is really object oriented, and we don't even, I mean, old mainframe people call it object oriented, but I mean, people writing JavaScript and Java, they handle different kinds of object orientation without thinking about it. Yes, of course, you inherit it and you write in patterns, stuff like that. So, going forward many years to 2011, because NetRex was eventually open sourced by IBM, this took some time. This was mainly due to IBM Legal. IBM Legal doesn't know about software, but has some rules and says, well, if it's related to PL1, it cannot be open sourced. If it has been a project, a product, an IBM product, we have to speak with all the clients, all the customers, before we can open source it. And when we did that, the person at IBM Legal was replaced by another person, and we could start over with the whole dance, because, I mean, obviously there are some relationships to PL1. I mean, if you look at a Rex script on OS2, and if you look at a PL1 program, it conveys the message that Rex is a kind of a scripted PL1. I mean, that was its intention, and that is how it turned out to be. If you see labels with colons after it, and you see procedures that shield their variables, it's more or less the same thing. Obviously, the runtime implementation is totally different. PL1 implementation for IBM was another drama that lasted many years, and had something to do with those movements in the 60s, where computing as it is now was defined for us. So after we finally got the source of NetRex, NetRex is written in NetRex. It has been bootstrapped. NetRex started on OS2, and it was written in OS2 Rex until version 0.50, where it could produce enough Java to self-host and make sure that NetRex is written in NetRex. So I hope that this doesn't come. I mean, some people's heads tend to explode if you explain this. I once met an old man in Uithoorn, the Uithoorn lab, which is near here, and they worked on VM there. And there was an old guy who said, well, you a higher level language, you have to write it in assembler. Which I said, well, of course, no, I can write a high level language in Prolog or in Lisp or in Basic. So I nearly got in a fight with him, because that's not how it works. And I should not speak about things I didn't understand. So, because he had made a high level language in assembler, of course. So when it was open sourced, I remembered that pipelines implementation, and I called Ed Tomlinson. Well, called, I emailed him, never spoken to him. Don't know if he is alive, but I mean, that's a problem with our operating systems. The first Rex user passed away last March, many people I try to reach are not really there, or are not interested or capable to do any computer work anymore. So I think we should cherish what we have, and I think I'm very happy that OS2 is being kept alive. Although I see mostly the main faces, the same faces as 2 years ago in Rotterdam, So we need to expand. Roderick and I spoke about how to combine racks and OS2 things. Now, people from the VM community also want, I mean, they have the same problem. The VM people, I mean, the active enthusiasts, because, I mean, there are 50,000 Indian boys who have to do this for work. And only if they really, really cannot solve a problem, they will be in touch and say, well, how you do this in Rex? But, I mean, those are not the people who are going to be member of a, of an OS2 or a Rex or a VM society and come to symposia. So this is the problem we also have with the Rex Language Association. So, I'm still not a certified plumber, although I made quite some pipelines in the past months, because, I mean, I finally had the occasion to work on ZVM and CMS and get to know how it's put together, how to write programs, how to debug problems, how to load them. This, of course, is because today's fashion is you run Linux on the mainframe under ZVM. I mean, when I did it the first time, the fashion was to run MVSs on it. And that was then put in the hardware, the VM part that virtualized MVSs is called Prism now. Even the Prism error messages are the old VM error messages, if you appreciate that kind of history. Nowadays, people are understanding that, I mean, it's better to plow a field with one ox instead of 1,000 chickens, which means all those data centers around us that are eating electricity and just making the air hot and stuff. I mean, you can all replace them by a few mainframe systems. I mean, and it's not like it's your whole floor. Now your whole floor is servers and HP machines and things that break all the time. Nowadays, the avant-garde of companies in Europe understands that you have to put in one mainframe and you run 20,000 Linux partitions on that, which goes fairly well. And you can even choose if you want to have ZVM, which is good for the older people among us, or you can have KVM, which is a Linux virtual machine type thing. And I mean, that would be awkward, because then I would be out of a job to do stuff like that. But well, let's have a look at pipelines after this rather long introduction, which is how it goes. What is it? It's invented by a guy in Denmark, and he is named John Hartmann. He is one of the knights of VM. And it has been put on TSO, but of course IBM never knows how to market a good thing. So, you know, the inventor of Rec was first fired, and then he was rehired because the customers were interested, and then he was demoted, and then he was made IBM fellow, so he could choose for the rest of his life what kind of projects to do. I always compare IBM with the old Eastern Europe socialist countries. I mean, there is a limit to things that you can run centrally. At a certain moment, it doesn't work anymore. So, data flow programming. When Unix, you know, after CTSS and Multics and Unix, it was Douglas McIlroy, who was actually a manager there in the team. He said, well, we need to put something together like, this is the original memo. I don't even remember where I got it, but he said, we need to be able on this new operating system to string data together like garden hoses and make it flow. So, well, you've got the presentation, so you can, it was obviously unreadable probably. So this is a Unix pipe. You do a list of your directory and you search something, and when you find two of them, you send it through something that's called unique, and you have the one thing that you were looking for. Well, CMS pipelines was inspired on that idea, but done right. So you can have parallelism, you can send data back, you can easily integrate with your, I mean, the thing about writing a Unix pipe stage is that it's deceptively simple, but very hard to debug. And in CMS pipelines, you can write your own stages in Rex if you want to. John Paul Hartman, IBM Denmark. So this is a bit a lot of text, but the thing is, you have a source of the data, you have stages, and you have a data sink, which is where it ends up. Now the stages are separated by pipes, the pipe thing, except in Germany where it's an exclamation mark, because in Germany they had things with code pages on the mainframe, which made everything different. So in the NetRex implementation of CMS pipelines, you can have NetRex programs in which you can implement your own stages. So most of the time the path that is taken is that you have a command, which I forgot to put in here, or a disk file, or a database, and you push data through pipes. And what also needs to be on this picture is then, when you have a stage that compares things and takes decisions, you can have another pipe and have that process in parallel. So one half of your data can go like this, the other half can go like this. And eventually you wanted to have it in a file or back on your screen, or you have it back in the database. So the thing that starts it is called a device driver, which is unfortunately the same word as the device drivers we know in OSs, which are different things, which are the things that, you know, in OS2 they are 16 bits and or 32 bits, and if they use DOS calls, then you cannot have them in the just last week I was cleaning out my book cupboard and I found Microsoft's OS2, and actually there are a few chapters on OS2 2.0 in by Michael S. Gogan, who was the architect of the 32-bit version. So the schism between IBM and Microsoft did occur quite late, I think. I think a great big part of the 32-bit version was already written when they decided to go their separate ways, and we know the rest. Microsoft decided to support the DLLs of the old version and didn't support the new version. IBM supported everything like they always do, so they just put 1,000 people on, you know, patching DOS programs and you know, the virtual device drivers that were put in Windows just to make sure that it didn't run on OS2, which were dutifully patched out again by IBM. Not those device drivers. These device drivers are just things that say, give me a file, and for every record, because we don't have streams in VM, so we don't have them in pipelines. You read records, and records are the units that flow through the pipeline. There's a literal device driver, which means you can just type some words in it and make sure that those go into the pipeline. There is a console driver. You can read from it and it gives you output. Most of the time it gives you output. It's not very popular in typing in input and see what comes out, although you could make something with it. Well, then you've got stages, which are also called filters. Most of the filters that are delivered with pipes for NetRex on OS2 are identical to the ones on CMS, which means you can just use the VM CMS manual if you want to know what those stages do, because stages like sort and unique and a lot of others, obviously, they have options, they have switches, they have ranges, and the intention is to have it compatible with the VM version. Which is an odd thing, because if I speak to VM people, they are not really ready to accept that it's compatible, and their first impression is they want to call it a toy. So you always have to, well, give me an example of a complicated pipeline that you use every day. Hey, it runs on the network version. Well, then maybe it's not a toy. But the thing is, I would have thought that those VM people would be the happiest with the existence of this product, because now they can on OS2 and on Linux and on Windows and on the Mac, they can run all their own pipelines, because, you know, due to intellectual property and ownership issues, not everybody has VMs running at home, and certainly not after their retirement. And some people didn't hear about Hercules still, or they have Hercules but they cannot get their hands on one of the freely downloadable internet copies of those operating systems. So I thought those people would be happy with it, but those are my critics. This is slightly different. Yes, of course, it's Java on OS2. What do you want?
Must be only for small things.
Yes, but still a lot of OS2 users in the VM community. I mean, there are still people who do their daily work on an OS2 copy with Communications Manager, I think, because I think the Windows version is called PCOM, Personal Communications. OS2 still have Communications Manager, and it still works for some people. And they
look
don't
at the simple example. Is this readable? Because that would be,
the Beamer isn't
of that good quality. The Beamer, it could use a higher resolution. It's not my screen resolution anyway. But so when we say this is a little, so the device driver, as we explained, is something that just pipes this text into the pipeline. Fortunately, the exclamation mark shows as a pipe here, because that's one of the things I recently changed, because the old VM people, they kept moaning about, yes, but it's an exclamation mark, it should be a pipeline. Well, as with the next release of NetRex, it is a pipe. And you can say, you can have as an option SEP, and then you can choose any separator you want. You can use an ampersand or an exclamation mark or a hash. You can choose anything. But the default now, for the VM people that kept on, that spent 11 years to complain about this, it's a pipe. So, and then we say we pipe that through an XLAT, which is translate stage, and then we have a quite involved compare pipeline, and then we have something that looks like if the cat was on your keyboard while you were typing it. And because we feed that literally into the pipeline as a compare stage, it's the unit test of XLAT, actually, because if it compares to something different, it will tell you something. So this is how a pipeline and a unit test work in one example. So quite some options on the translate stage. All these stages have these kind of options. You can feed it its own translation table. I mean, most of the people I know want to go from EPSIDIC to Unicode and vice versa. But you can translate actually anything that you want. It is in the documentation, but the documentation still isn't that complete yet. The next release of NetRex, which is 3.08, which is coming out, I hope somewhere this month, it can be next month, is the first that will have the documentation of pipes included. So people can, it was there for a number of years already, because it used to be a separate package, but of course it used to use a lot of things that were used in the compiler itself also. So this was merged, and it's a standard package in standard networks. So the idea is, if you have networks on OS2, you also have pipelines, and you don't need to worry about installing it and things, because installing networks is always something on itself, because you have to know how Java works and things. I don't really influence is that Java needs a class path and has some tricks of avoiding the class path, but still needs a class path. It's the problem in every operating system, and the thing that you need to learn as a system programmer first: how does it find things? In which sequence does it find things? And so, I mean, some systems like MVS have done. They have elaborate schemes of in-memory memory areas which are looked in a certain sequence, and then on a certain set of files, then on another set of files. Well, this Java has something alike. If you don't know that, really, it's very hard to get networks to run. But if you have it running, it's not a real problem anymore. So it's fairly old, and people stopped working on it. I called Jeff Hennick, and I said, why didn't you go on working on it? He said, well, Java just was too slow in those days. But I mean, if we could, well, I don't know if anyone remembers his PC from 1997. It's not the speed that we are used to today. And they've got all things like pipelines, and also the Java compiler is a whole different beast than it was then, because then it decided to compile everything to bytecode, and sometimes it would decide to compile all that bytecode to native code, and then if it was already redundant and you had finished your coffee, your program would run. And it's quite different now. It just starts interpreting everything, and only if it feels that some of the loops are running hot, if you do it more than 200, 2000 times, it pauses for a very little while and tries in parallel, if possible, to compile your stuff to machine code. Which is why, if you give it some attention, you can write benchmarks that outrun C++, because C++ only statically at compile time knows what's happening. Java actually can run at the computer, look at the processor in the memory, and see what's going on. So it only, well, it's a lot better than it was. SourceForge with a C instead of an F. It's in a Git repository now. Last time I did this presentation, 20 years ago, it was in Subversion still. Is there a Git for OS2?
Yes.
Well, I need that, because then I can just, it's Java, so I write on the Mac, or I write it on the mainframe sometimes, if the boss needs to think that I'm working on the mainframe, which I'm actually not, because I'm working on network. I mean, I can, everywhere there is Java, you can build networks. Actually, you only need the runtime version, the JRE version of Java. You don't need the compiler. We give you a compiler for free in the networks jar. And you always need the previous networks jar to build networks, because it is written in networks. I need a Git repository, the Git code, so I can write on OS2 directly, which makes for better debugging, obviously.
What's the minimum Java version requirement?
It's 6. And just yesterday night, I said to my wife, I'm going to tell these OS2 people that networks is running on OS2, so let me check. So I fired up my ecom station, and it didn't, because in my energy of implementing redirection on Rex.io, I used a collection class, a linked deck, which was in Java 7 for the first time. So this is why I changed that into a linked list, which is not too bad. I mean, we have a little less protection for multitasking errors, and it's a bit slower. Well, it's slower. It will be microseconds, of course. But I'm happy to tell that the Java I have for OS2, which is Java 6, written by some Russian guy, it's running on there.
He's next.
Yeah,
he
That's good. I'll stay then. Because we'd like to have at least a Java 8, of course.
Oh, you're the next person in the queue then. Yeah, so.
Good. But I think, can I just buy him over with coffees, or does it require more?
Vodka.
Okay, so even if you're on Windows, but I can skip that part, of course. So the pipes implementation, as opposed to the one on CMS, is not an interpreter, it's a compiler. It compiles to network source, which compiles to Java classes, which you then can start. Of course, I have a pipe.cmd file that just does that, and you don't see any difference, because I needed to explain that in the time that it compiled was slow and you needed to wait for it and it took a second and things. But it's now, the real processor driven things or a computer are almost instantaneous. There's no hard disk in something like this, so that's almost instantaneous also. But still, the pipes implementation predates the interpreter in NetRex. NetRex also has an interpreter, which is, it's nice for development. You edit, you press a function key and your stuff runs and you see the next bug and you edit it, and this is nice. You don't have to compile stuff and then start it, type Java. So in 2000, which is almost 20 years ago now, NetRex got an interpreter, and I did some experiments and try to have the pipelines interpreted now, so skipping the compiler stage. It's not worth the trouble. If you just have a batch file that compiles it and runs it, you don't see the difference. It's always faster than your mainframe turnaround time, because you on the mainframe you're not the one person that uses it. You're one of the 200 concurrent users and one of the 4,000 users that are defined on it. And on the mainframe you always have some lag. Interesting thing is, I started out in 85 as a systems programmer. I found out that if you give people the best response time, they complain. Because if it's between .2 and .3 seconds, or sometimes .7, they say, well, you never know when it comes back. If you just hard code, and you can do that in TSO, you can say it's always minimal 1 second. Nobody complains. It's a double or five times the response time, but because of the extreme predictability, nobody complains. There's a large number of stages delivered with the product. They are all, because the whole product is inspired on CMS, they are all compatible with CMS. Also, you can make your own stages easily in NetRex. If you want, you can also do that in Java. If you're like me, you write it in NetRex, and if your boss wants to have Java source, then you just tell NetRex to generate the Java source and give it in that form. They're not going to look into it anyway. There's even a format option that makes it look like you written it by hand. So, if you installed it, you type in a test pipe, and it, the stage is called test, which is the name of the stage is here. You get a test.class out of it. You pipe a literal into it, but you take the arg, which is the argument, which is what the user types. So some words are the input. You duplicate both of them 990, you get 1,000 then. Then you count them, the number of words, because count has a lot of options. You can also say count lines or count bytes. And you put that to the console, and if you get 2,000, then you know that your pipeline installation works. And that's it, I think.
And I didn't overrun too much, no.
You mentioned also, I think, when you were in Rotterdam, that this type of code is still actually being used hidden in mainframes at banks.
This is running the world.
At financial institutions.
So Visa and Citibank and, I mean, all the large people that move our money, all the stockbrokers. If you would take out Rex and pipelines, the world would come to a stop. Actually, I was in a very large bank in Holland in, let's say, when SEPA was introduced, which is already a number of years ago. There was a software product selected, of course, and there were 16 servers ordered, and they all had to have 2 gigabyte Java heap sizes. And of course, it didn't run, which I could have predicted because of, I mean, if you have such a large heap size, you don't know anything about writing software, probably. And the SEPA implementation of that bank was actually written by 2 old guys in MQ and Rex. And this, most of your SEPA payments, I mean, this was in the time, I don't know if you remember which bank it was. I'm not going to mention the name because I work at all of them and I don't want to have someone say, well, you know what he told about your bank. This was when you got your amount and you got in the comment, you got in your description, you got SEPA payment. Because that was the part that they couldn't fix in the Friday afternoon that they did. I mean, SEPA was a legal requirement. It needed to go into production in somewhere in October in some year. So, and if you didn't do that, then you were liable for, you know, fines and things and bad publications. So they had to write it literally in a week or so. And it was refined over a number of weeks till it actually got your, you know, your accept gyro number in it, which is, and your description, and there was a checksum checked. And eventually, they did that all when it was in production. They changed the gears while the car was driving. Yes, Rex is some of the great unknowns. And I think OS2, I mean, still there are some machines somewhere. If you are in Germany, then sometimes you say, hey, this is an OS2 machine.
Yes.
They still have them. And I think, Virtual still sells, Virtual is retired now, but his successor at IBM still sells a lot of OS2. And he told me it could never be open source because half of it is Microsoft. A part of the Rex interface to the GUI and stuff is Amigas. They actually swapped Amiga Rex. Amiga Rex is IBM's implementation swapped for some of the Windows stuff that Microsoft couldn't get straight, but Amiga already had that. So there is all kinds of stuff of which nobody knows who owns it now. But they're so afraid that people are, I mean, if they open source it, they will say, ah, that's mine. Give me money. Anyway, are there questions? Well, thank you very much then. It was